To God be the glory. Let us share these announcements for this morning. There are several, and I'm going to move quickly through them. Those that are worshiping with us virtually, good morning to you, and your worship slides should reflect what I am saying. First, we want to acknowledge our February birthdays, and we know that some of you have already had birthdays, some will have birthdays, but today is somebody's birthday. I wonder who. So we say happy birthday to Sister Velma. She came in, we were singing, and she was doing her thing. And from what I could tell from Facebook, she'd been partying all week. Amen. But praise the Lord. When I keep up with y'all, I'd be like, now I know that you need to be at church because you was out too late last night. So she got here bright and early this morning, so I didn't have to go in Pastor Mama mode with her, okay? So we give God praise that nothing gets in the way of that worship, amen. That's right. We're glad that you have been having a good time and fellowship with friends, so on and so forth. We give God praise. Amen. Be mindful of, today is Heart Health Awareness Month, this month is rather. And so let's take care of our hearts. Let us take care of our hearts. And the way we can do that is by resting, by eating healthy. Don't just say, I eat. By eating healthy foods, by exercising, whatever that looks like for your ability level, doing what you can, and limiting alcohol and tobacco use. And yes, we have to say that to the saints because it's just keeping it real. Limit your intake because you are wanting to be healthy for the Lord and taking care of the temple. Amen. So be aware, you have an insert that gives you some information about your heart health. So be aware, be mindful of your salt and just all of that. And we know as people of color, we have some challenges with hypertension, so on and so forth. And there are things that we can do to monitor that. Amen. This week, the Precepts for Living Bible study at 11 o'clock. So tune in. If you have any questions, see Sister Ellis, and she will update you. And then for the evening study, we are in Romans 9, and I've asked everybody to read 9 in its entirety. The following week will be our Ash Wednesday virtual service, and our presiding elder will be sharing the word on that day. This week on Thursday the 16th, the missionaries will be having their meeting at 2 o'clock. I'm going to ask the missionaries to make sure you get that schedule from those checking you in. If I remember correctly, I did leave the flyer out there. If not, we'll make sure you get it. And then on next Sunday, I know it says today, but next Sunday will be our lay meeting at 2 o'clock. And we will make sure you have all of your Zoom sign-in information next Sunday. Amen. Amen. Thank you for indulging me with the morning announcements. We give God praise and we give God glory for the opportunity to have something going on to be able to announce. Amen. Amen. So we give God glory for that. Although it's sometimes our announcements may be a little cumbersome, but we thank the Lord that ministry continues. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Praise the Lord, saints.
Praise the Lord.
Good morning. Praise the Lord, saints.
Praise the Lord.
If you have that joy, that Jesus joy, why not stand to your feet and let's invite God into this place? Amen.
Amen.
Whatever is on your mind, if it's not about Jesus,
amen.
Remove it.
Take it away, Lord.
Whatever is in your heart, if it's not about Jesus, remove it.
Amen.
We come to give God the glory. We come to give him the praise. We come to thank him for allowing us to see another day.
Yes.
Gracious God, you are welcome. In this place.
Yes, you are.
Merciful God.
Yeah.
You are welcome in our hearts.
Yeah.
Gracious God.
Yeah.
We need you in our spirits. Oh, Father God, come bless as only you can. Come heal, Lord, as only you can. Come and comfort, Lord, as only you can. For Lord, you are welcome.
Yes.
In this place. You are welcome, Lord, into our temples.
Yes.
We await you, dear God. Fill us up, Lord, and we'll be careful to give you the honor, the glory, and the praise. Lord, you're welcome. You're welcome. You are welcome. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
I'm so glad you're all the same.
I really did, Jesus.
And you showed me.
Amen, church.
Amen.
Jesus love. How many of you are familiar with God's love?
Yes.
That agape love.
Yes.
That unconditional love.
Yes.
That in spite of love.
Yes.
If you know what I'm talking about, then you ought to be willing to stand to your feet and affirm that which you believe in. If you know love, and love is God, then even those of you that are home with us virtually, this is an opportunity to declare what you believe. Church, what do you believe?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Praise the Lord. Let us continue in worship with the ministry of giving. We give God praise for his faithfulness throughout. He continues to show how much he loves us by blessing us. And we are blessed to be a blessing. Amen.
Amen.
And so we come now for the opportunity to give. We've been giving in worship and our attentiveness to the Spirit of God. And now we can give in a monetary way. For those who were prepared when you entered, you were able to give. If not, you certainly will be able to as you exit. We give God glory for being a giver of all good and perfect gifts, giving us what we need to sustain us, giving us what we need even for the pleasures of life, giving us what we need to give back to him for the upbuilding of his kingdom. So we thank the Lord for the wonderful gifts he continues to give us. And we know that Malachi asked the question, will a man rob God? And the response was that we rob God with our tithes and our offerings. And I pray that you won't leave here today with something that belongs to God. Amen.
Amen.
That you would give him what you owe him, what is due to him. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for the blessing of giving. We thank you for how you have shown us how to give. For you continue to pour into our lives every day. And we thank you. We thank you that you will supply all of our need according to your riches and glory. We thank you, Lord God, that you are the giver of every good and perfect gift. We thank you, Lord God, that you bless us with an abundant blessing, that you open up the floodgates of heaven and you pour out a blessing for us that we don't even have room enough to receive. So we thank you for that kind of blessing that causes us to have an overflow and be a blessing to someone else. Bless all that we have received, Lord God, in hand and virtually on Givelify, and those gifts we will receive, oh God, and let us be good stewards, and that it would be used for the upbuilding of your kingdom and for your glory. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. We give God glory. We give him honor. We give him praise. And let's just give God some praise right now. Whatever we have, God gave it to us. Whatever we're able to give, God doesn't measure us against each other. He deals with us according to what he has given us. So all of us can't give the same thing. All of our 10% don't look the same. All of our offerings don't look the same. So you don't have to worry about what your brother, your sister's doing. Just worry about what you're doing, because that's between you and the Lord. And so we thank the Lord. And the Lord will remind you of you being stingy.
Yes, he will.
I ain't got to say nothing. I can look at your envelope and have and think something about it, but God will let you know, because I ain't in your pocket or your bank account. But God knows what you got, and God knows what you give. And so it's between you and God. Amen. So we thank the Lord. Isn't it amazing that God trusts us? Well, we ain't been always trustworthy. It's amazing that God will trust us with all of it and then say, give me some back.
That's right.
Anybody in here give somebody all of it and then you ask for allowance. Ask for, can I have a few dollars out of my own money? Okay, I didn't think y'all did that, but God gives us all of it and then say, you gonna give me back some of my money? Amen, amen. Praise the Lord. Okay, I'm gonna shift gears. I went there. I'm gonna shift gears. If you look at the order of service, it says celebration of black love. If you look at your worship cover, it says celebrating love. Now, we're celebrating love on a couple levels, on some different levels. We're celebrating, as you look at the colors, we're celebrating our blackness, right? Celebrating loving ourselves, celebrating our history. We're also celebrating romantic love, right? And we're celebrating the love that Reverend Saunders lifted up, that agape love. We're celebrating love today. And I was just excited to have this opportunity to celebrate some lovers among us, okay? And so I have a list of some individuals who that we're celebrating today. And some might not be here, but we will certainly reach out to them. So this is what I'm going to ask before I even begin. I'm going to ask that if your spouse is here and you're not sitting with them, go find them. If your spouse is here, now if you don't have one, don't go looking for one. But if your spouse is here, you're already married, okay? If your spouse is here, there you go, Brother Henry. You know, okay, there she is. Go to her. Go to your bride. If your spouse is here, go. If your spouse isn't here, okay, it's okay. It's still going to be good, okay? All right, so Brother Robinson is finding his way to his bride. Amen. She was waving like, I'm over here. I'm over here. Amen. So, praise the Lord. He's making his way. I didn't say he had to be in a hurry. I just said get there. Amen. So we want to celebrate these couples, right? And for a number of purposes. First of all, we know that marriage isn't easy. So I can raise my hand on that because I've been married. I ain't married, but I've been married. So marriage is not easy, okay? All right, so we know that. And so when we reach a place where we're able to celebrate those who have had some longevity, we want to celebrate that. And I think there's no better place for us to even encourage and lift that up in the church. So the first thing I'm going to do is call out the names of our couples, okay? And then we're going to do something else. All right, so these are our couples, and I see Brother Steve Evans came in. I don't have his name on the list. How long have you and Sister Arlene been married? Uh-oh. All right. I'm going to give you a pass on that. Okay. All right. There we go. All right. So these are Murchison's married couples. Brother Lloyd and his bride, Beverly Walton, they've been married for a year. Married couples, if you're here, even if your spouse isn't here, stand up, please. I know they can't stand. Brother Philip and Sister Shirley Vantrese Heath, they've been married 2.5 years, got married during the pandemic. Brother Johnny and Sister Angela Blackman, 4 years. We're praying for them. Brother Edward and Sister Valerie New, 7 years. Brother Bobby and Sister Margaret Armour, 8 years. Brother Corey and Sister Jessica Hawkins, 9 years. Brother Duran and Sister Stephanie Jackson, 16 years. Brother Reggie and Sister Monique Tindall, 20 years. Praise the Lord. Brother Jimmy and Sharon Wilkes, 23 years. Brother Kerwin and Gladys Mershon, 24 years. Brother Carl and Sister Ann Bryce, 26 years. Brother Steve and his wife, Earlene, 27 years. Brother Calvin and Sister Christopher Weaver, 26 years. Brother Jeffrey and Sister Felicia Smith, 29 years. Brother Robert and Sister Ruth Vance, 30 years. Sister Christine walking through the door now with her mama. Brother Ronald and Sister Christine Gayfield, 31 years. Brother Leroy and Sister Doris Rice, 32 years. Brother Glenn and Sister Theda Oliver, 35 years. Brother Ryan and Sister Reba Snow, 35 years. Brother Tracy and Sister Lillian Ann Dyson, 37 years. Reverend Brother George and Sister Marjorie Tyson, 39 years. Amen. Brother Elvin and Sister Betty Vaux, 46 years. I cheated them out some years. Amen. 46 years. And praise God, Brother Daniel and Sister Yvonne Dukes, 47 years. They are here today. Praise God. Brother William and Sister LaWanda Shockley, 47 years. Y'all got married the same year. Brother Calvin and Sister Charlene Gunn, 47 years. She's the doorkeeper today. Praise the Lord. Brother James and Sister Eleanor Robinson, 53 years. I need the Sister Crystal, go get the Washingtons for me. Oh, there she is. Okay, they were staying. Okay, he raised his cane. All right, he said, I'm here. Brother William and Sister Mary Washington fought 54 years. Amen. Brother John and Sister Dolores Clayton, 57 years. Reverend John Henry and Sister Edith Vance, 58 years, and she's here today. Brother Eddie and Sister Sally Jones, 59.4 years. They got real accurate. They got the calculator. Brother Charles and Sister Dolores Mosley, 62 years. And can't nobody beat this one. Brother Leroy and Sister Emma Knight, 75 years. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. So, I want to share this with you. Yes. I didn't say the Robinsons. Okay, I thought I did. I said Sister Elnora, Brother James Robinson, Brother Henry, and Sister Mary Robinson. I'm sorry, 53 years. Correct me. I thought I said it. I jumped over that Robinson. Praise the Lord. Thank you for reminding me that I skipped it. So I want to say this to you. We give God praise for your love. We give God praise for your union. We give God praise for the commitment you have made to God and to the one that you love and the one that you will stay with, whether it's been a year or 75 years. We give God praise and we give God glory. And before I go on, is there anybody else that I need to acknowledge before I go on? All right. I ain't asking nobody who looking for one. I ain't gonna look at them because they ain't up here cutting up. They up here cutting up. I ain't gonna look at them. Amen. All right. So I want to share this. So you stood before God and whoever witnessed your bond, and you made a pledge. You made a pledge from that day forward that you would take the one that you united in holy matrimony with for better, for worse. You made a vow that you would love them for richer, for poor, in sickness and in health. You promised that you would love and cherish them until you were parted by death, according to the holy ordinance of God. And you said to them, and to this vow, I pledge you my faithfulness. We give God praise for you, and we know that it hasn't been easy. We know that it's been some questionable days. We know there's been some challenging days. But we celebrate your love today. We celebrate your marriage, and we lift you up in prayer. And we ask God for continued strength in this journey. And as even as you look around the room and you see others, encourage each other in the Lord. Encourage each other to know that some of the very things you said you would do, you're experiencing. You're experiencing sickness. You're experiencing some lack, perhaps, some seasons of your life. But know that God loves you, and God will continue to bless you. And so we want to dedicate this song to you, and it is one that really deals with the love of God, but the words are so fitting for you to even say to each other. And we'll tell you who the artist is, because you might want to get home and play it, and it might just set the right atmosphere for you. I'm just saying. Amen. But listen to these words, and look at, if your spouse is here, look at them. I've married folks before. They said their vows looking at me. I say, I ain't marrying you. Look at who you married. Telling me what you're going to do. Tell the person standing next to you. Put a little volume on it. That's right. Hold on to them, Sister Doris. The tenders, act like y'all know each other. It's all right. Forever is a long time. And tell them, that's how long I love you. That's how long I love you. Forever is a long time. No matter what you're going through, no matter how hard times get, promise to love them forever. I see some folks acting like they know each other, and others just act like they're standing next to each other.
I'll be by your side. No matter what you face,
You won't be lonely. This is Jason Nelson, in case you want to play this. Play it for it. And make this one of your songs you can play. And just say, you can count on me for always. Forever is a long time. And that's how long I'll love you. That's what God says to us. No matter what. Even when I don't like you, I'm still going to love you. Forever is a long time. Sister Dora's holding on to her man like, you know, you ain't getting away. It's been how many years? He ain't going nowhere. He ain't going nowhere. And for some of you, I remember when you made those vows. Amen. And when I think about the Blackmans, I married them. Probably our last in-person Thanksgiving Day service, I buried them in my office. So they were a gift to each other on Thanksgiving 4 years ago. You can count on me. Can you count on each other? Remind each other, you can count on me. In sickness, in health, for richer. For poor, for better, for worse, you can count on me. Forever is a long time, but that's how long I love you. That's how long I love you. Say forever. Reverend Saunders, I might need you to go down here and lay hands on the tech team. They need deliverance from something. They up here cutting up. Hallelujah.
I'm forever committed to you.
And I know it's easier said than done, but with the help of God, hang in there. Yeah. Hang in there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No matter what your life be,
yeah.
I'm gonna be by your side.
While this continue to play, and you might need to repeat it, I'm gonna ask y'all something to do. Sister Denise and Sister Sierra and Jennifer, would you all pass out those little tokens to the couples? Stay up here. Just a little something. And that's how long for her couple. Just a little sweet. Just take a few and give them to the couple. If you see it, raise your hand or stand back up so they'll know who to share with. That's how long. That's how long. Amen. Them. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Let's give God some praise for our couples. Praise God. To God be the glory for what God has done. And God created marriage, and we just want you to continue to honor the commitment that you've made to God and to each other by loving each other forever. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. I love the Lord. He heard my cry. To God be the glory for all that the Lord continues to do. Amen. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for the opportunity to celebrate your love and the love you have given us one for the other. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight. Lord, you are my strength and my redeemer. It's in the mighty name of Jesus that I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. It's looking forward to this day to celebrate love. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. The selected scripture for today is 1 Corinthians chapter 16. 1 Corinthians chapter 16 and two verses, verses 13 and 14. And I'm lifting this up this morning in the Amplified Bible. And it reads, "Be on guard. Stand firm in your faith in God, respecting his precepts and keeping your doctrine sound. Act like mature men and be courageous. Be strong. Let everything you do be done in love, motivated and inspired by God's love for us." This is the final chapter of this letter. And in it, Paul is providing guidance and wisdom about, of all things, setting aside money for God's work and giving according to one's means. He shared his travel plans of Timothy and Apollos and urged the Corinthians of how to welcome them and greet them. He gave final farewells to the church in this chapter as well. Now, I found it interesting that this chapter opens up talking about giving, talking about money matters. And I kind of chuckled because, you know, we get real funny when we talk about money.
Yeah, yeah.
We really do. We act some kind of way when it's about us giving, but this is how it starts, and Paul urges the church in verse 13 to watch, to be alert, to never let their guard down so that they would not fall into the traps that false teachers would set. He was exhorting them not to listen to false teachers and false doctrines and to stand against those who mishandle and abuse the word of God. So it's important for us to understand that the enemy sets traps. And some people, they know enough about the Bible to try to trick you into not believing the truth of God's word. There are some who will tell you some things that will cause you to doubt your faith. But Paul says to be alert, to watch, and to be careful. In other words, he was telling the Corinthians that they needed to be spiritually mature and stop acting like those who don't know any better, but to be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. See, sometimes if we're not careful, we begin to act like the world. And Paul was telling them in the church in Corinth that they needed to be on guard, they needed to be alert, they needed to make sure that they were not acting like others. And that, then he told them to do everything in love. Yeah. Paul was disheartened with the opposition and tensions in Corinth. And there are other chapters in the books of Corinthians that lets us know that there was some trouble in the church in Corinthians. And he had been teaching them and exhorting them and correcting them and doing all this thing and these things. And he never gave up on the church, but rather he continued to minister to them so they will remain true to God, that they will remain hopeful, and that they would rid themselves of worldly beliefs that were contrary to God's truth and sinful behavior, and just become spiritually mature. He was exhorting them to grow up. He was exhorting them to do everything in love, not out of the motivation they were doing, all the things they were doing that caused problems, because the greatest division in the church is the lack of love. When we clown with each other, we do things that are ungodly, we do things that God's not pleased with, it's because we are not operating in love. Love must prevail in the hearts and behavior of believers in the church. The command to love is at the heart of what it means to be a Christian. You cannot claim to be a Christian and not love. You cannot claim to be a Christian and you don't know how to treat folks. You cannot claim to be a Christian and don't operate in love. And Paul tells them, do everything in love. Be motivated by love. The call to live a life marked with love is a consistent message throughout Scripture. Jesus preached to love God and others, and that they were the greatest commands. In the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. And some translations of it say, with all your strength, with your everything, love the Lord your God. This is the first and the greatest commandment. And the second is like it, love your neighbor as yourself. Jesus said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments. That's simple. If you love me, you'll do what I say do. Now, we can't say that in the natural, because everybody ain't got to do what you say do to show that they love you. But the Lord says, if you love me, keep my commandments. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. 1 John 4 says, we love because he first loved us. John 3:16 tells us, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him would not perish, but have eternal life, have everlasting life. Love is throughout the word of God. When Paul closes his first epistle to the Corinthians, he returned to the theme of loving God and loving others as the believer's ultimate ambition. We ought to strive to love. And I know, you know, sometimes it's hard to love folk. We ain't always lovable. And all of you that we acknowledge for being, you know, married for as long as you have, some days you might be saying, what's love got to do with it? Right now. Okay. So we know this is not an easy thing. This is not anything to be taken lightly, but it's serious. And he wanted their ultimate ambition to be love. He closes this letter and he's reminding them of that. And among other things, now I want to just tell you a little bit about this church that he's writing to. And he's closing this first letter. This is the church that he had dealt with division with and quarreling. You know that sometimes folk in the church are divided. Sometimes there's quarrel. Sometimes there's tension. He dealt with them because they were suing each other. There was lawsuits among the believers. Can you believe that? It seemed like it was written yesterday. they were suing each other. They were clowning at the Lord's table. They were ungrateful at the Lord's supper. They thought it was a meal. They didn't see it as something sacred and holy. And there was selfishness. And they were going to the Lord's table unworthily. And there was jealousy over spiritual gifts. And who has the best gift? And the gift that has the most attention. So on and so forth. They were having all kind of drama with gifts. And they were having disorderly worship. Can you imagine being in the house of the Lord and everything just messed up? Now the doorkeepers are supposed to keep order. But you're supposed to keep your own self in order. But they were having disorderly worship. So this is the church that Paul is talking to, that they had all these type of issues. And he's saying to them, do everything in love. If you do everything in love, you won't have all that other drama. So we know that Christians sometimes carry on in the church, and this is a constant competition is among them, and people are acting hateful and sitting on this side because they don't want to have to encounter somebody on that side, and all that kind of foolishness, being jealous and causing harm, just not getting along, acting like the world. And Paul wanted to emphasize and remind the Corinthians that everything they did must be motivated by love. Paul had repeatedly underscored this principle to the Corinthians so that they would always remember to let love be their highest goal. Be motivated by love. If we're motivated by love, it's just some things we won't say. And some things we won't do. We might think it, but we can shut it down in our mind. But if we are operating on love, there are things we just won't carry out because God is telling us to love and we don't want to harm our brother or our sister. Love for God and fellow human beings is to inspire and govern everything that we do. Some things we can do, but we ought not do. Why? Because love is what's keeping us and encouraging us. And earlier in Corinthians and in the love chapter that we frequently hear at weddings, Paul pointed out the most excellent way, stating that love is the most valuable of all of the gifts of the Spirit. And he says there, if I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor, give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Without love, all the other gifts of the Spirit fall short, whether your gift is prophesying, serving, teaching, encouraging, giving, leading, showing mercy, healing, helps, speaking in tongues, interpreting tongues, discernment, etc. If the foundation is in love, they mean nothing. All of the gifts are essential, but they are worthless if they are not driven by love. There is no one that's more special to God because of the gift you have. So we ought not worry about who's operating in one gift, because if it's not motivated by love, then you just have a gift. If it's not motivated by love, then you're not going to be blessed with how you use the gift, because it's all about you. If it's motivated by love, then your gift can be a blessing to you and God will bless you for being a blessing. If it's motivated by love, then you're selfless rather than selfish. If it's motivated by love, you do it unto the glory of the Lord, not for any recognition, not for anybody to call your name, but you do it because God said that we ought to love each other and use our gifts for his glory. He said that love is patient. I know you have to be patient with some folks. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. Some folk get mad just for nothing. It's not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects. It always trusts. It always hopes. It always perseveres. Love never fails. You can't go wrong if you operate in love. I'm not saying that you won't get hurt. I'm not saying that your feelings won't get hurt. I'm not saying that you won't be disappointed in life. But if you operate in love, everything will be all right. This description of love helps us to make sense out of Paul's instructions to do everything in love. To do everything in love means that you are patient. You know, some people got the patience of Job, whatever that means. That's something we say. But some people are patient. So you can do everything in love by being patient, by being kind, but don't worry about what other folk have. You ain't got to envy what other folk have. You ain't got to boast about what you have, because everything you have came from God, and the one who gave it can take it away. So while you busy talking about I'm all this, I got all that, you know, you can be like Job and end up losing everything. But you got to realize that every good and perfect gift comes from above. And so we can't boast in the things that we have that God has given us, but we ought to operate in love, knowing that we're not worthy, knowing that we don't deserve it, but yet God keeps on blessing us anyway. To do everything in love means we may forgive. We have to forgive. And some folk made up in their minds, it's just certain things I'm just not going to forgive. Sister Jennifer, what I'm not going to do. That's the mentality. That's like a little private joke. But that's the mentality that some people have. What I'm not going to do is forgive you. What I'm not going to do is forget what you said to me. What I'm not going to do is act like such and such didn't happen. What I'm not going to do, but that's not doing everything in love. If you keep reminding me, and what you're not going to do is forgive, and what you're not going to do is forget, then you're not operating in love. Because if you got to keep reminding me of what I did and what I said and what I didn't do when I said I would do it, then you're not forgiving me. So you're not doing everything in love. So you can't keep a record of wrongs. You can't keep reminding me of what I've done wrong. You can't keep reminding me of what I said and didn't come through. And you can't keep getting angry with me if I keep messing up, because love is not easily angered, and love does not keep an account of wrongdoings. And if all of us start keeping account of stuff people said to us, thought about us, did to us, we would be miserable carrying all that mess. You got to let it go. Do everything in love. You got to shake it off. We got to realize that nobody's perfect. We got to realize that we mess up sometimes. We got to see ourselves and the things that people do to us and realize I said some things I shouldn't have said to other people as well. So to do everything in love, we got to begin to humble ourselves and realize that none of us have arrived, and realize that God is calling us to love him and to love our neighbor as ourselves. And so we do everything in love. Love has to be the motivating force to help us get through our relationships, not just romantic relationships, but all relationships that we have. We got to be patient and kind. We got to help each other along the way. We got to forgive. We got to forget some stuff. We got to move on. You got to let it go. If you do everything in love, then you won't hold on to your past. That's not love. Mad just because you can be mad. Doing everything in love means that you deal with your anger. You deal with your frustration. The scripture says, don't let the sun go down on your anger. Some things you got to settle before you let some time pass. Because if you go to bed mad, you're going to wake up madder. So you got to deal with some things. Scripture tells us that we can be angry but sin not. You ain't got to like everything somebody do. And you can express sometimes how you feel about it, but don't let it go into a sin and you just flip out. And now what you did is worse than what they did. To do everything in love means that you rejoice in the truth of God, and you look for good, and you reject evil, and you trust, and you hope in the things of God. Doing everything in love means that you look beyond each other's faults. None of us, all of us are a work in progress. All of us got some stuff we working on. All of us mess up. All of us say some things. We look at people the way we shouldn't look at them. We ain't said a word, but the look says it all. All of us do that. And then we have to check ourselves.
Yeah.
And Paul even explained that when we give, because remember this chapter opens up with giving. When we give in the church, it has to be motivated by love. You don't need to be announcing how much you gave and all that. God ain't impressed with you. Because you wouldn't have it unless God gave it to you. So even when we give, it has to be out of love. It has to be out of commitment to God. It has to be backed up and held together with love, or it counts for nothing. When we serve, the foundation has to be love, or God isn't pleased. If we complain and every time we do something, oh, I got to preach again, Reverend Saunders. These Sundays has come too fast. Here I am again. And if I'm laboring over this to the point that I don't like doing it, God's not pleased. So when I get up and stand and my mind ain't right and my attitude's not right and it's not in love and faithfulness to God, God is not impressed and God is not pleased. And God's going to deal with me of my attitude.
Right.
And whatever you do, if you're doing it grudgingly, if you're doing it in a spirit that's not motivated by love, then God is pretty much saying, why you keep doing it?
That's right.
If you ain't loving me, why you doing it? If it's not unto my glory, why you keep doing it? If you don't want to usher, don't usher. Because they used to be the ushers were the first people that we see. Now we know the check-in ministry is the first people you see. But when they hit them steps and see you and you ain't right, they could turn back around. So if you ain't feeling that you ain't operating in love, you just might need to stay at home day. You need a virtual day. Because you looking at people sideways. Look at your screen sideways. So if you're not doing it in love, then we got to check our motivation and why we're doing the things that we do. We have to do it in love. We got to get our priorities straight, and our motives must be pure. We should not center it around us. Doing everything in love means we are concerned about pleasing God and not pleasing man. Doing everything in love means that we are promoting unity with humanity, that we are coming together as God's children, and we're loving on each other and encouraging each other. When we acknowledge the couples, that was an opportunity for us to show them love and encouragement and support. It was in love that we shared love with them. And so we got to do everything in love, not for any type of accolades, but just to give God glory. Doing everything in love means that we're trying to be more and more like Jesus. Anybody trying to love like Jesus? Because you know Jesus got some deep love. You know, we got to be more like him, because Jesus even prayed for folk that was crucifying him, saying, "Forgive them, Father. They don't know what they're doing." So we got to have that kind of love that you even concern when your life in jeopardy, even concern about somebody else and loving them and praying for them and asking God to help them when they make our lives even miserable. Doing everything in love means we are following the example of Christ in our lives. Doing everything in love means that we are praying even for our enemies. Doing everything in love is being kind and good to those we think don't deserve our kindness and our goodness, and letting our actions and our words be motivated by love. Now, this don't make us a wimp. This don't make us weak when we love this way. This is the way that God wants us to love. He wants us to be able to allow love to help us rise above all of the hatred and all the circumstances and all the drama that people put in our lives. We got to love folks in spite of them. I know that sometimes I'm a piece of work, but still love me. Please love me. God's still working on me. I know sometimes I can be real extra, but God's still working on me, okay? And so we had to be mindful that that's how all of us are. All of us got some stuff, and we got to look beyond that and see what God sees. We ought to see the Jesus in you. The Jesus in me loves the Jesus in you, and we got to be able to love each other and see God in each other. Do everything in love is being moved with compassion. When we see things that are going on, we don't just go, "Oh, you know, that's just so terrible." But we're moved with compassion like the Lord, and we want to do something about it if we can. We want to do something about that situation. We want to help that family. We want to assist them. We want to be of aid to those who have needs. That's what doing everything in love is all about. Not to say, "I did so-and-so. You know, I paid so-and-so bill for so-and-so." If you tell somebody you did it with the wrong motivation, if you need me to know you did it, your motivation wasn't right. If you call somebody name or something they told you confidentially, and now you feel the need to put their information on blast, you did it with the wrong motivation. You didn't do it in love. You did it trying to act like you somebody. Doing everything in love means that you're that good Samaritan. When you see somebody in need, when you see somebody on the side of the road, beaten down, robbed, left for dead, that you go and assist them. That's doing everything in love. Doing everything for love is like the work of the missionaries, being able to assist those in need, those who need help, those who need food, so on and so forth. Helping those that you can, and helping those that you should. And love doesn't judge why people are in the situation that they're in. If you worried about how people got there, you're not doing it in love. If you say, "Well, they work every day, why they don't have enough to feed their family?" Well, they don't. They made some mistakes. Pray for them and help them have a meal to eat. We got to realize that our motivation has to be in love. You can help somebody, but yet you still talking about them. Your motivation is not love. Doing everything in love means you let love guide your thoughts, your actions, and your words. There's certain things we just ought not say to each other. It's just some stuff that ought not even cross your lips. You know, there ought to be some boundaries when we do everything in love. Be careful what you say to folks, because you don't know folks' circumstances. Why they doing this and why they look like that. You don't know what they've been through. If you do everything in love, just keep your comments to yourself. You might find out that the reason why this person looks like that, the kind of night they had, the kind of situation they in, and why you judging and asking questions and getting on in folk business, you want to just be glad to see them. Do everything in love. Doing everything in love means walking the path of becoming more like Jesus, who loved humanity unconditionally, even to death on the cross. Jesus said to his disciples that we ought to be identified or recognized by a love. We can tell, the world can tell we belong to the Lord, and we can tell in each other that we belong to the Lord by our love. They will know we are Christians by our what? By the hats we wear. They'll know that we're Christians by how many times we go to church. They'll know we're Christians by how much we put in the offering plate. They'll know we're Christians by how we dress and what church we go to. No, they will know we are Christians by our love. They will know that we are Christians by our love. A new command I give you, that you love one another as I have loved you. You must love one another. Jesus sets the example of how we are to love one another. We are to love our neighbors as ourselves. I know some of us, you know, things are different now. There was a time that neighbors were like family. We go in and out of each other's house and all that. It's a little different now. So we don't have, you know, the kind of the neighboring spirit like we used to have back in the day. Some people don't. Most people don't. Some still do. But when it says neighbor, it's not just folks that live next door to you. Okay, love your neighbor as yourself. Love those who are in the community. Love your neighbor as yourself. Husbands are to love their wives as Christ loved the church. You know, Christ gave up his life for the church. You ought to be willing to sacrifice your all for your wife, for your bride. He says, love your wives as Christ loved the church. And wives, submit to your husbands. I know y'all don't like that word, submit, in 2023, but the word of God says submit to yield. And so if you have a godly man and you praying for him, you don't mind submitting. But if you didn't hook up with somebody you unequally yoked to, you got another issue. And that's another sermon for another day. So he said, be not unequally yoked. So if you yoke to a man of God, yoke to one who submits to God, then you can submit to him because, you know, he's yielding to the word of God. 1 John 4:11, beloved, if God loved us, we also ought to love one another. Let love be genuine. Abhor what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Let brotherly love continue. But love your enemies and do good and lend, expecting nothing in return, and your reward will be great, and you will be sons of the Most High. And I just want to say this. When you do everything in love, sometimes people find themselves in a situation where they need some help. And they're in a situation where you help them, but you know they can't pay you back. Because if they pay you back, it's going to be another setback. So sometimes you got to help somebody with no expectation of getting it back. They might say, I'm going to pay you back. You know, I'm going to try to do it. But you know good and well that if they try to double up and pay you back, they're going to be in the same situation. And down the road, they're going to be asking for help again. Sometimes you just have to give in love, make the sacrifice, and just pray that they're able to get it together and move on rather than saying, when are you going to give me my money back? But do it in love and make the sacrifice. Do everything in love. My brothers and my sisters, love. Love your children. I know they make you mad. They acting like you didn't bring them to church when they was little. They acting like they don't know Jesus. They act like they ain't saved. They're like, they don't know the Lord's Prayer. You taught it to them. You taught them 23rd Psalm. And they just act in some kind of way. Keep on loving them. Keep on encouraging them. Be patient. Be kind with them. Do everything in love. Parent in love. Serve in love. Love requires an unconditional commitment to the one who is loved. In his command to let all be done in love, Paul was reminded of all that he had addressed in the church. And I know that love can be complicated. Love can be tricky. Love can just really be something hard to deal with. But it's not just about the feeling of deep affection and romantic love. Biblically, love is deeper, it's richer, it transcends all emotion. So you can't love because you feel some kind of way. That was when you got married. You got married and you felt some kind of way. But as you go on, that warm and fuzzy, you know, it kind of fades away sometimes. And so love has to supersede all of that. Because sometimes you ain't feeling all that. Monique laughing, I ain't gonna even try to get into that. sometimes it supersedes that. And you know, and the marriage bond, and you roll over, you wake up and look up and you say, Lord, what have I done? And then for folks that have been married some decades, you say, you don't look like what you used to look like. You don't do what you used to do. So we know that love is beyond the warm and fuzzy. Love is beyond emotion. Love is beyond that. But do everything in love. Let me tell you what God did in love. God sent his son. He was willing to make the ultimate sacrifice. Let me tell you what God did in love. He looked beyond our faults. And he saw our needs. Let me tell you what God did in love. He forgave us. He forgave us of our sins. He didn't treat us according to our sins. He didn't treat us according to what we deserve. Let me tell you what God did in love. God kept on blessing us even when we messed up. Let me tell you what God did in love. We said, Lord, I'm forever committed to you. I'm going to serve. I'm on the battlefield, and I promise you that I'm going to serve you till I die. And then we got off the battlefield. But God kept on loving us. Let me tell you what God did in love. When we said no, God still said yes. When we turned our back on God, God said, I love you with an everlasting love. Let me tell you what God did in love. God said, nothing can separate you from my love. Let me tell you what God did in love. God says, I'm going to love you, and I'm going to be with you. I'll never leave you, and I'll never forsake you. Let me tell you what God did in love. God said, wherever you go, I'm going to go with you. God said, I'm going to bless you in spite of you. God said, I'm going to bless your going and your coming. Let me tell you what God did in love. God said, forever is a long time, and that's how long I love you. I'm committed to you. God said that I sent my son to die on the cross because I knew where you were headed, because I love you so much. I didn't want you to die in hell. I didn't want you to die in your sins. And he paid the price. We had a debt that we could not pay. It was a debt that he did not owe, but he paid the price. And the songwriter said, now this is love. They hung him high and they stretched him wide. And on the cross, he hung his head and he died. That's love. That's love. He showed his love for us in so many ways. And he keeps on proving himself to us over and over again. We mess up. We going about our business. We enjoying the blessings of God. We ain't said thank you. We haven't done anything but what we wanted to do. But God's still there just waiting on us. How many folk can you leave and go back to later? Only God. God's still there. Ain't never left. He never changed his mind. He changes not. He's the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. God keeps on loving us over and over again. And for us to do everything in love, we got to love like God. For God is love. He is the very definition of love. And there is no greater love than a man will lay down his life for his friends. And God calls us his friends. That's love. I know y'all in love, you all huddled up and everything, but this love, it's not based on circumstances. It's not based on whether you do right. It's not based on even your faithfulness. God loves us in spite of us. This love, nothing changed. God had a made up mind that he's going to love us anyhow. He has a made up mind he's going to forgive us anyhow. He has a made up mind that I will not withhold any good thing from you. He has a made up mind that I'll be your shepherd and your shall not want. He has a made up mind that no weapon formed against you will be able to prosper. He has a made up mind that as long as I'm with you, you don't have to worry about the whole world against you. And he has a made up mind that forever is a long time. And that's how long God will love us. Do everything, every single thing, let it be motivated in love. Amen. Amen. Do everything in love. Even when folk don't want to cooperate or act right, love them anyway. They acting like the world, just love the hell out of them. Just keep loving them. Just keep loving them. And allow God to work on their hearts. Do everything in love. How you serve, how you minister, how you give, how you live, do it in love. We pray for deliverance for folk who just hateful.
Amen.
Go to church. Say, I love the Lord. He heard my cry. But you, I mean, they something. It's like, I'm trying to see some Jesus in you. We got to keep loving them. We got to keep loving them. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We extend the invitation to Christian discipleship. And this is an invitation that's given to you in love. Because God loves you, he's inviting you to be his child. Because God loves you, he is letting you know that he's here for you and he loves you with an everlasting love. Because God loves you, he's letting you know that you can choose to love him today. Today is the day of salvation. Please stand to your feet. We extend this invitation, not from me, but from the Lord, the one who first loved you, the one who chose you, now gives you the opportunity to choose him. Anybody here today who doesn't know the Lord in the pardoning of your sin, I want to introduce you to one who loves you in spite of you, who loves all the stuff that you won't even admit about yourself. You know, the things that we know about ourselves that we keep to ourselves, God knows those things and God loves us anyhow. The things that we would never tell anybody else, we would never say it out loud, God knows it and loves you anyhow, loves us anyhow. Is there one? If you're worshiping with us virtually and you want to accept Jesus today, it doesn't matter where you are. It doesn't matter what you're doing at this moment. You can just stop right now and accept Jesus. The word of God says if you believe in your heart and you confess with your mouth that God raised Jesus from the dead, then you shall be saved. Salvation is yours. You can claim it today. Is there one? The invitation is extended, first of all, for Christian discipleship, salvation. And discipleship means you're going to follow Jesus. If there's one here today who wants to recommit yourself to God, you want to renew your love for God. You want to say, God, I love you, but I know I ain't been acting right. I love you, and I know I've been a little distant. I love you, God, and I want to get a little closer to you, have more intimacy with you. I love you, Lord, and I want to come back closer to you. If that's you, you can rededicate your life to the Lord. And if you don't know the Lord, don't play with this. Just come on. Sister Vance, if you would go around this way and just come on up here with me. And if you don't have a church home, and the Lord is speaking to you, don't hear my voice, hear his voice. Because this ain't my church, this God's church. If God is speaking to you, then you ought to come. If you're worshiping virtually and God is speaking to you, obey him. He says, if you love me, you keep my commandments. Do what God says do. Don't play with God. Because this is the only moment we have. We don't have next Sunday. We don't have to man and pookie them here. Okay, I'm going to wait to so-and-so here before I do it because I want them to see me do it. You don't have it. All you got is this moment right now that God is giving you breath. That's all you have. So don't try to wait till you have an audience of who you want to see it. Just tell them about it. Because you might not make it then either. They might make it and you won't. This is your time. This is your moment right now. And if you need prayer, we will pray for you. So the invitation is extended, first of all, for Christian discipleship. Secondly, for recommitment. Thirdly, for membership. And lastly, for prayer. If any of those meet your needs, remain standing. Otherwise, you may be seated. Is there anyone standing for salvation? Is there anyone standing for recommitment? Is there anyone standing for membership? All are standing for prayer. Amen. Amen. Sister Vance, you came down, so I certainly want to share with you. You come down for prayer. Yes, ma'am. blood. And he gave his life. I was hoping it was an extended version. Yeah. That's love. That's love. That's love. He went to Calvary. Say, a wretch like you and me. That's love. There's no greater love. That's love. Let me tell you what they did. They stretched him. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. For me, he died. That's love. Thank you, Lord. Just picture this love on the cross. Stretched him. He hung his head. And they didn't take his life. He gave up his life for us. That's not how. It ain't over. It didn't end on the cross. He rose. He got up again. That's love. That's not how the story is. Don't you end on Good Friday. He got up. That's love. Yes. Oh, what love. Thank you, Lord. That he would give his life. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. We thank you for your love, oh God. We thank you for your love, oh God. We thank you for your love, God. We thank you for your love, God. We thank you for your love, Lord. We thank you for your love. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your word that reminds us of your great love for us. We thank you, Lord God, that you first chose us, oh God. We thank you for the opportunity to choose you. We thank you, Lord, that there is no greater love than this, that a man would lay down his life for his friends. We thank you, Lord God, that you love us with an everlasting love, an unconditional love, an immeasurable love. We thank you, Lord God, that we can't even fully wrap our mind around how great your love for us really is. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you look beyond our faults and you see our needs and you meet us just where we are in love. Lord, we come, those who are standing and others who are in need of prayer, we come, oh God, drawing closer to the cross, closer to you, oh God, knowing that we need a special blessing. You know your children. You know who's standing. You know who desires to stand. You know who's worshiping virtually. You know what the needs are. And we come right now, Lord, because of your great love, you will minister to each one individually and to all of us collectively. We pray, God, right now, for the needs among your children. We pray, oh God, as Sister Vance comes down and we lift her up as well as her husband. We pray for them, oh God. We pray that you will continue to manifest your love in their lives, that you will continue to cover them and keep them and heal them and restore them in the mighty name of Jesus. We look around and we see others standing, oh God, and some who are standing for healing, healing in their hearts, healing in relationships, healing in their finances, healing in their mind, healing in their relationship with you. We lift them up to you right now in the name of Jesus. We pray for marriages. We pray for longevity. We pray that they don't just stay together, but they stay together in love. We pray, oh God, that they will be patient and kind and long-suffering, one with the other. Continue to minister to each of these couples, oh God. And we pray, oh Lord, for other relationships we have in our lives, that we will do everything in love, that we would forgive, that we would be patient, that we will help each other and encourage each other along the way. pray. We pray, oh God, for those who are in bereavement, have lost loved ones, oh God. And you said, blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted, oh God. You are able to heal our broken hearts. You are able to restore us. You are able to give us peace even in a time of loss. And we thank you right now for your comforting spirit, oh God. We pray, oh God, right now for those who are just confused about life. It's just so much going on that they cannot begin to understand. There are many things we won't understand. There are many things that we don't know about tomorrow, but we know who holds tomorrow. So we put our trust in you. Provide comfort for them right now in the name of Jesus. Those that are worshiping with us virtually, oh God, and they just need a special touch. You know them. Minister to them right now. They would even feel your presence even now, oh God. And we continue to pray for all of those, not only the ones who are here, but we have other loved ones and church members that we have not seen. We pray, oh God, that your love will bring them back to the fold. We pray, oh God, that we won't call them and fuss at them for not being here, but we'll call them to say, I love you and I miss you. Help us to do everything in love. Help us to be patient with those who are reluctant to be back in person. And even though we might not understand it, we don't have to understand it. We can just love them where they are, oh God. Just help us, oh Lord, to be motivated by your love, to emulate your love, to imitate your love, to speak out of love, to think things that promote love, and to act upon this love that you've given us in our hearts. Lord, we thank you. We love you with all of our heart, mind, and our soul. And when we fall short, oh God, help us to be mindful of your commandment that we ought to love you more than anything. We ought to always put you first, oh God. And so we pray as we love you more, we can love each other more. As we draw closer to you, we can draw closer to each other. We pray, oh God, that you would help us to forgive. Forgive those who have harmed us. Forgive those who have disappointed us. Forgive those who have betrayed us. Forgive those who have denied us. But you know all about that, God, and you forgave. Help us to forgive, oh God, even those who've done the harshest things to us, who have hurt us the deepest. Help us, oh God, to be able to let it go so you can heal our hearts. Let it go so you can minister to us. Let it go so we can have healthy relationships one with the other. We put it all in your hands, oh God. We put it all in your hands. We put it all in your hands. We put it all in your hands. That we would trust you to minister to our needs, oh God. Because we're not alone. You said, I'm with you. Whatever's going on in your life, I'm with you. I'm going to be with you forever. I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I'm committed to you. You are a priority to me. Thank you, Lord. There's nothing we go through that God doesn't know and God doesn't understand. God is with you. God is with us. Don't ever feel like you're all by yourself. For God is always there in the midst of it. He's your refuge. He's your strength. The ever-present help in your time of trouble. We thank you right now for your love. Minister to our hearts right now. Where more love is needed, give it to us right now. Where forgiveness is needed, give it to us right now. Let us release forgiveness in those situations. Where peace is needed, let us speak peace right now, even in the midst of storms. Where joy has been snatched from us, let us claim our joy right now in the name of Jesus. Help us, oh God, to live this abundant life that you came for us to live, that we will live it to the full by doing everything in love. And it's in your name that we pray. Amen. 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 Let us just pause for a minute and think about somebody that you know. It might be you, but think about somebody you know needs some love. They've been displaced, marginalized, overlooked, neglected, and they just need some love. They need to know the love of God and feel his love. I know you might be mad at them, but get over it. They need love. Think about all those families in Turkey. They need some love. This displaced, unhoused families all over the land. Family members we ain't heard from, don't know what's going on with them. They need some love. Don't call folk to be nosy. Call folk to let them know you love them and you miss them. Whoever it is that you're thinking of that needs some love, just say their name. You can say it out loud. You can say it in your spirit. Just say their name. God hears it. If it never crosses our lips, God still hears their name. Help us to show them love, God. Help us to show them love, God. Help them to know your love, unconditional love. I know they feel unworthy and unloved, but help them to know that you love them anyhow. Help them to feel your love today, oh God. Thank you. And even as the day goes on, if you think about somebody else that needs some love, just call their names out. People in the hospital, ain't nobody going to visit them. They need some love. People in nursing homes and they loved ones are just giving up on. They tired of going over there to see mama, daddy. They ain't doing nothing but laying in the bed. They need some love. They don't know if they've been fed. They don't know if they've been washed. They don't know anything about them. They need some love. The one that's in the bed and the one that needs to get up and go see about them, they need some love. Do everything in love. Amen. Amen. Thank you for that selection. It was a blessing. Praise the Lord. We have any visitors today? You are visiting with us? Two visitors, they looking at each other like we're going to stand. Hi. And what's your name? That's a familiar last name. And who is that next to you? Deborah Calloway Johnson. Those are my two sister-in-laws. I'm just messing with them. Amen. God bless you. So glad that you all are here. And we continue to pray for you all and Amen. Give God praise. Amen. Any other visitors today? Amen. Well, thank you. Thank you for those who are in worship today. Invite somebody to come to church with you. That's how you can show some love. Invite them to come. Sometimes when we're going through, we kind of retreat and try to stay away from people and try to go through by yourself. But that's where the enemy wants us to be when we're going through, by ourselves. But when we forsake not the assembly, we come together, we can encourage each other and love on each other. Even if we can't fellowship like we used to and we stand lingering in the sanctuary for 30, 40 minutes after church is gone, just seeing each other is an encouragement. So encourage somebody to come to church, and that's the way to show them love.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Let us receive the benediction. We give God glory, we give God praise, and we give God honor. Amen. I'm going to ask you to stand today for the benediction. Sometimes we do and sometimes we don't. But I'm going to ask that you stand. Amen. Thank you for those who got the memo who have on some red. Amen. Brother Steve, who are you rooting for today? Oh, I'm trying to see. You got on red, number 15. Can't see. Okay, I'm just wondering who you want. Okay. You see, if you don't see it from the jersey, let me show you my cap. Amen. You know, I don't have a dog in the race. But since the Chiefs happen to be, in the 3rd Episcopal District, and we're part of it, I'm just rooting for them. And I know some of y'all talk about, black quarterbacks and this, that, and the other, and all that. Y'all do what y'all do. But may the best team win. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. And enjoy. And remember what I said about today is Heart Health Day. I know you have planned your party refreshments. So do all things in moderation as you celebrated your Super Bowl party. Amen. Take care of your hearts. I know you like them hot, hot, hot buffalo wings, but take care of your heart. Do all things in moderation. Amen. Praise the Lord. Enjoy the rest of your day. Lord, we thank you We thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
We thank you. We thank you for the love that's been shared in this place. We thank you for the example of all these devoted couples that stood, oh God, who are in this thing for forever. We thank you for them, and we lift them up to you, God. We pray for those who are thinking about getting married, that they would think very seriously to know that forever is a long time. And if you can't commit to forever, it's best to rethink it. Amen. Lord, we thank you that you sang that song to us and said you committed to us for a lifetime, for forever, on this side and forevermore. We thank you, Lord, that we can depend on you. We thank you, Lord God, that you will be there for us through thick and thin, through rich and poor, through sickness and in health. You said that you're committed to us. Thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for loving us the way you do. Now to him who's able to keep us from falling and present us faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forevermore. Let the people of God say amen, amen, amen. 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 God bless you and God keep you. Blessings to each and every one of you. Amen. Those that worship with us virtually, to God be the glory. Thank you so much for being with us today. We love you, and you can't do a thing about it. We love you with the joy of the Lord and the love of God. Amen. Amen. Continue to celebrate love.